make it possible. He's able. God is able. Well able to do anything but fail. God is able. Well able to do anything but fail. He's able to make it possible. He's able. God is able. Well, able to do anything but fail. For what seems impossible, he's able to make it possible. He's able. God is able. Well, able to do anything but fail.
Please join me in prayer as we ask God's blessing on the ministry of the word. God, we've come today to worship you. We thank you for the reminder that indeed you are able and that you never fail. We know, God, that as we worship, we desire to hear a word from you. But we are so aware that unless you anoint our ears, we can't hear you. That unless you anoint our lips, we can't speak your truth the way you want it to be spoken. God, we're so aware that unless you anoint our hearts, we'll just be indifferent or even reject or rebel against your truth. So we ask your anointing of our ears, of our lips, of our hearts, to be receptive to you. And we are confident, God, that you can make us doers of your word and not hearers only. So that's our prayer. Make us doers of your word and not hearers only. In Jesus' name, amen. For past several weeks and for the next few weeks, we have been bringing messages about the earth on the general theme, the earth is the Lord's. And finally, this Sunday, we actually get to that scripture that is Psalm 24, the first verse. The earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof. That's been our theme. We've been talking about storms and rain and rainbows. And we talked about creation. But today, I want to bring to your attention the central verse of this whole series of messages. The earth is the Lord's. Psalm 24. The earth is the Lord and its fullness, the world and its inhabitants. These verses, it's only 10 verses in Psalm 24. It is a processional liturgy, a song with lyrics intended to be sung by people who are entering into a temple or into a holy place to worship God. I can think back 25 years or more as a lifelong member of this church, but there was a time when we would begin our Sunday morning services with a processional. The choir would gather in the back and process down the aisle. The pastor and ministers would process down the aisle. We would have a processional hymn, and we would have a processional. Some of you maybe have never seen that. Others of you remember coming down the aisle in a processional. But in the Old Testament, the whole book of Psalms, are songs intended to be sung in worship. And lest we forget, David, who is the author, not of all of them, but most of the Psalms, David wrote them. David was a king. David was a military leader. But David was also a musician and an administrator of music. Okay? So he not only played instruments, he gave direction and he organized the music ministry of the people of Israel who were under his leadership. So it is said by scholars that this particular psalm was composed and performed when the ark was returned to the temple. And that was a big deal. The ark of the covenant, which for Israel represented the presence of God, had been lost. It had gotten away from them when they returned with, and they're bearing into the temple the ark, which represents the presence of God. This is a special music that's composed, a special liturgy that's composed. And I want to suggest to you that this Psalm 24, with its 10 short verses, offers us a simple template for what I want to call worship 101. Worship 101. The most basic lesson that you need for worship comes from this Psalm 24. Worship 101. There are three parts of this curriculum. Who we worship, how we worship, and why we worship. Worship 101. Who we worship, how we worship, and why we worship. So let's begin with who we worship. Well, that's where the psalm starts. We worship God. No one else and nothing else. Now, you're going to see in a moment why that's important. We worship God because there's a whole lot of confusion about who God is and what God has directed us to do when we worship. Well, there's no confusion here. We worship God. The earth belongs to God. All the resources, the fullness, everything, all the potential of the earth belongs to God. The world belongs to God. And all the people who inhabit the world belong to God. So there's no question or confusion. And you don't have to do an extensive study of the origin of the text to know that Israel, they're making this proclamation in the proximity of people who were worshiping all other kinds of gods. So they're like, we're worshiping the God who made the world. Well, guess what? When we worship God in, what year is this? 2022 in the United States of America, we're in the midst of people that's worshiping all kinds of things. Now, they might not call it idolatry, but it's certainly not the God, it's not consistent with the God that we know in the scripture, the one who made the world, the one who loves people, the one who loves the planet, the one who does not excuse hatred. That's the God we're worshiping. So we just need to be clear. I'm saying 101, real basic. Who do we worship? We worship the God who's the founder of the earth and the sea. The God who established the floods and the ongoing systems of hydration. Now, give me a moment to talk about the salt water and the fresh water. In the literal translation, it says, he has founded it on the seas and establishes it on the floods. All I want to bring to your attention is the difference in the tense of the verb. He founded it on the seas. When you read that Genesis chapter 1, the separation of the land from the sea, the chaos, the Spirit of the Lord moves on the face of the water. The sea is the salt water, the ocean. It's already there. And then God brings the land into existence and separates the land from the sea. That's what he founded it. But what he establishes in the present tense, not past tense, is the flood. Well, what is the flood? The flood is the fresh water that comes from the sky. I think in Genesis chapter 1, he separates the sky from the ocean. Any water that comes from the sky is fresh water. It's clean water. It's pure water. And that's the water that flows through the streams and the rivers. And so that is what God is establishing. God establishes, because that's ongoing. That water is coming. That water is flowing. The salt water and the fresh water. It comes from the rain. It flows through the streams and rivers. It empties into the oceans. All of that fresh water, all of the rivers and the bays and the streams, they empty eventually into the ocean. And the ocean is where the water becomes saturated with salt. So there's salt water and there's fresh water. But all I'm trying to say to you is that God set all that system in motion. The water evaporates from the ocean, forms the clouds, then the cycle continues to water the earth and to sustain all forms of life. God set these global ecological systems in operation. God owns and operates the world as we know it. And so we worship God who made us and who sustains our existence in the world. That's who we worship. Now, how we worship? Worship 101, part 2. Worship is how we respond to the realization that there is a God. God is not detached from us. God loves us. In fact, God is love. And God is holy. Here's the problem. How can an unholy people worship a holy God? How can an unholy people worship a holy God? And I think this psalm gives us an answer to that question. Unholy people are changed and transformed when we come into the presence of a holy God. The psalmist asks and answers the question of who can worship God. He says, who can go up on God's holy hill? Who can stand in God's holy place? That's built in. Imagine this is a song that they're singing, perhaps antiphonally, you know, might be the sopranos and the alto and the tenor. Somebody, they're singing this to each other. Who can ascend to the hill of the Lord? Who can stand in God's holy place? So when you sing that question, you sing the answer. We worship God as the people who can ascend to God, people who can stand in God's holy place with clean hands, with pure hearts, and without idolatry or deceit. Okay? Clean hands, Clean hands. I've thought a lot about that this week. It means there's not blood on our hands. And there are too many of us standing before God with blood on our hands. How are we going to cleanse the blood off of our hands? The cleansing comes from standing in the presence of a holy God. We have no righteousness of our own to bring before God. But we want to come before God with an awareness, God, cleanse us. Fix our hearts. Pure heart means, what's your motivation? Hand is what you did, your action, your pure heart. If you stand before God with a pure heart, we had this, wasn't that our Women's Day theme a few weeks ago? Create in me a clean heart. That's a prayer. You don't just come. You don't just show up with a pure heart in the presence of God. That's part of your worship. God, purify my heart in your presence. My heart, I got all kinds of thoughts. I got all kinds of motivation, like all kinds of distractions. God, show me how to make my heart purely devoted to you. Jesus said, the pure in heart will see God. So when we come to worship, we don't come saying, yeah, I'm pure, yeah, I'm clean. No, God, cleanse my hands, cleanse my heart, purify my heart, my motivation. Give me the right attitude when I come to worship. We worship God with clean hands, pure hearts, without idolatry. In other words, don't worship God today, then worship some other God tomorrow. Worship God without deceit. Don't pretend like you're a Christian today and then you something else tomorrow. Deceit. Be who you're going to be. And if you're going to stand before God, don't have an alternative identity that you take somewhere else. Be who you are. Be transparent, not deceit, not trying to trick or manipulate or mislead people without idolatry, without deceit. I don't want to sound self-righteous. We never want to be self-righteous in God's presence. But if you all been reading about that Southern Baptist Church, they have a big problem on their hands because a lot of misconduct got covered up, denied, covered. Oh, no, it's going to make the church look bad if we tell the truth or if we look. We don't want to listen to these victims. And what I'm saying, it's not just point fingers at them. That's a bad reflection on the whole body of Christ. Because we're not to be so deceitful that we will just cover up when people are being hurt, just cover it up and try to smooth it over because we don't want the leadership to be embarrassed. No, deceit means you're playing games with God. And so our desire when we worship God, the clean hands, the pure heart, God, fix us. If we've done wrong, show us how to make it right. Rather than pretend nothing happened. And then you know what they do? Then you blame the victim. The very person who's been victimized and hurt, when they open their mouth to say something about it, you point fingers at them. Oh, well, she's a so-and-so, so-and-so. It's her fault. No, it isn't. Tell the truth and be truthful. That's what repentance is for. That's what confession is for. That's what reconciliation is about. When something has gone wrong, what are the steps that we have to take to fix it? And those steps need to be taken with integrity and not with the intention to deceive. Worship, then, is more than the song or the sermon. It goes beyond the pulpit and the pew. When we go up, when we stand before God in a posture of worship, by faith we are allowing, we're inviting God's holiness to transform us, to fix us. How are we going to have clean hands unless we confess our wrongdoing and ask God to forgive and correct our actions? That's what happens when we worship. That's what's supposed to happen. You don't come with arrogance. You don't stand before God with self-righteousness and say, God, just show me, help me, cleanse me, fix me, God. Forgive me for what I've done wrong and help me to make better decisions the next time. How are we going to have pure hearts unless we invite God to renew our thinking and guide our emotions so that that better thinking will result in better action? Anyone who wants to worship God must reject idolatry and hypocrisy. Idolatry and hypocrisy plague the 21st century Christian church. That's why there's so much confusion. Well, how do Christians believe this? How do Christians fall for that? How do Christians vote for that? Because we're confused. And instead of worshiping God, we're worshiping people and systems. And the hypocrisy is that mentality that says you just fake it till you make it and hope nobody finds out. You put your own soul in jeopardy when you worship people, worship positions, worship politics rather than God. And then you turn your religion into a mockery when you lift up holy hands to God every Sunday and then deceive everybody every other day of the week. So you come to church with holy hands, and then every other day of the week trying to hurt somebody. And even people who never set foot in a church can tell what kind of hypocrite you are. That's some terrible criticism. You're a Christian. You go to church, but people look at your behavior who don't go to church and say, wait a minute, I thought you was a Christian. Because you don't have to be a Christian to know what to discern a hypocrite. So all I'm saying is, we have worship equips us to bring our behavior in line with our confession. And so when we come before God, we invite God, cleanse, purify, sanctify, show me, correct me, fix me. That's the attitude that we should bring to worship. Not that we're so perfect, but that God is so holy that the only way we can stand in God's presence is with an openness to God showing us, directing us, cleansing us, correcting us, and showing us the way. In verse 5 of Psalm 24 says, the person who worships with clean hands, pure heart, without idolatry, without deceit, will receive the blessing of the Lord. But I want to say, if you look at the literal translation, not the modern translation necessarily, but the literal translation, it doesn't say he shall receive the blessing of the Lord. It says he carries away a blessing. You see the difference? Receive blessing is good, right? But carry away the blessing is a whole different thought. You take blessing with you when the worship is over. You're not just blessed when you worship. You didn't just get blessed, but you take the blessing with you when the worship is over. And you not only take blessing with you, you take righteousness with you. You take salvation. The God of your salvation has blessed you. You take salvation with you. So salvation is not just something you read on the program and say, okay, we are saved. No, you take it with you when you go. when you go home, when you go back to work, when you go to the marketplace, when you're in the city, when you're on vacation. You take righteousness and justice and salvation. You carry it with you. You can't worship God or be in God's presence, lift up your heart and soul to God without being blessed. You can't help but be blessed when you worship God. You can't help it. You're going to be blessed when you worship God. God is cleansing your hands, purifying your heart as you worship so that you will not be tempted to worship the world's idols. And to lie and cheat and deceive your way through life when church is over. If you take a stand for God in worship, God will bless you with everything you need to succeed in life. And don't be afraid of success. I know some people say, oh, God didn't call us to be successful, be faithful. What's the point of being faithful if you're not going to be successful? So let's do both, okay? Let's be faithful. But let's value, let's celebrate success. When we see each other succeeding in something, let's celebrate, encourage that person. Don't say, I wasn't called to be successful. Yes, you were. You called to be faithful and successful. Because the fruit of your faithfulness is success. That's accomplishing God's purpose. So when you stand for God in worship, every blessing, every victory, every open door, every vindication, every outcome, you are inviting God, make those things happen in my life. That's what we're doing when we stand before God in worship. The psalmist says you can carry it with you. Why do you think the enemy tries so hard to keep us from gathering for worship? Maybe you didn't notice. Why do you think the enemy tries so hard to discourage people from coming to church? To convince us, when we do come, to despise the preacher, to be mad about the music, or have something to say about what somebody got on or what they don't have on? To get distracted and confused and put off. The enemy knows that you will be blessed when you worship God. One thing you can't say about the devil is no dummy. It's just that we put ourselves in a bad position when we let the devil outsmart us. The devil knows you'll be blessed when you worship God. The devil knows you'll be saved in the presence of God. The devil knows what will happen to your life when you're filled with the power of God. And the devil knows that you will carry all that blessing and all that power with you when church is over. So think about it. All the things the enemy does to keep us out of church. The devil just celebrates when people disconnect from one another. Disconnect from the power and the presence of God. And disconnect from one another. That same enemy is overwhelming the world with idolatry and deceit. And our best defense against these things is to worship God. And then carry the blessing that we experience in worship, to carry that blessing with us everywhere we go. As a generation of them who seek the face of Jacob. Just one mention of Jacob's name just comes in there. To seek your face, O Jacob, or the God of Jacob. But let me just say a brief word about Jacob. Jacob dreamed of a ladder. In fact, we have a song, "We Are Climbing Jacob's Ladder." It's one of the traditional Negro spirituals. But Jacob dreamed of a ladder, Genesis chapter 28. And the ladder that he dreamed of, angels were ascending and descending up and down the ladder between heaven and earth. And while he was dreaming, he recognized it was a message from God. Genesis chapter 28, verse 16. Then Jacob awoke from his sleep and said, "Surely the Lord is in this place, and I did not know it." And he was afraid and said, "How awesome is this place? This is none other than the house of God, and this is the gate of heaven." Okay? That's what Jacob said when he awoke. There was just a dream. When he awoke from the dream and he recognized what he had seen, he said, "This place where I am, this is the gate of heaven." Worship opens the gate of heaven. Worship opens the gate of heaven. Not for us to enter heaven, but for God to enter our world. You see, I'm not saying that when we worship, we're going to heaven. No. Worship opens us to God so that God can enter us, so God can enter our world, so that God can bless our world through our witness. Same thing Jesus spoke about. He said, "Let your light shine before people so they can see your good work and glorify your Father in heaven." Jesus said that same principle. That when we worship, we invite God, enter into us, enter into our worship, enter into our world, enter into our witness, so that the world will be blessed by the justice and righteousness of God by people who have been in the presence of God. Jacob started out as a trickster. He was a master of deceit. And if you read about him from the very, in fact, he came out of the womb tricking and deceiving. Because he pulled the heel of Esau. He wasn't even born yet. And he's manipulating, tricking. You know, he tricked his brother, his twin, tricked him out of his blessing. He was a master of deceit. He was a master of trickery. But Jacob wrestled with God, wrestled with the angel all night long. And he insisted, "I'm not going to let you go until you bless me." And at daybreak, he wrestled all night long. At daybreak, God changed his name from trickster to prince. His name was changed from Jacob. Jacob means trickster. But God changed his name to Israel. And Israel means prince. And then God blessed him. And then God vindicated and rescued him. Because both of those times when he had that encounter with God, he was running from somebody. Because when you are a master of deceit and trickery, you've got to be constantly looking over your shoulder. Because once they find out they've been flim-flam, they're coming after you. And so Jacob is running, but he has these transformative experiences. What I want you to see about the God of Jacob, Jacob was so far from perfect. He was a terrible person. But in the presence of God, he was transformed. He was changed. And so we are the generation seeking the God of Jacob, seeking the face of Jacob. Let's position ourselves so God can speak to us, can change us, can transform us, and then can use us for God's purpose. Worship 101 The third thing is why we worship. I'm going to close with this. The benefit of worship is blessing, salvation, righteousness, and justice. And these are the blessings I'm saying that we carry with us. Verse 5, you carry that with you from worship. Blessing, salvation, righteousness, and justice. But the consequence of our worship, that's what I mean by the why of worship, is something more. And that is expressed in verses 7 through 10, the last verses. And these are verses that have been put to, so we've sung these in so many different songs and different cultures, different times. Lift up your head, O ye gates, and be ye lifted up, ye everlasting doors. The King of glory will come in. Anthems and hymns and choruses. These are words that we've heard these words. We've probably sung these words before. But what I want to show you here is that when we worship, this, the consequence of our worship is something more than being blessed. Being blessed is good. Being blessed is important. But that's not the whole thing. When we worship, we are inviting the King of glory to come into our space, into our hearts, into our minds. How are you going to have a pure heart if the Lord doesn't rearrange your thinking? We're inviting the Lord to come into our lives, into our plans. Don't you dare plan anything without prayer, without saying, is this what the Lord would have us to do? Or you just plan it and just say, God bless it. That's how a lot of us do. Just bless this mess. Well, why not say, God, help us to get a good plan. Help me to think this through. Show me. Lead me to the people who give me good advice about this decision that I'm making. When we worship, we invite the King of glory to come into our space, to come into our future. Lift up your heads, O ye gates. When we lift the gates and worship, and by the way, it's a whole nother message. This is just worship 101, so you don't get this in this class. But they're gatekeepers. Ushers are gatekeepers. If you're an usher, your job is to usher people into the presence of God, not just to stand at the door. But your spirit, your mind, your posture makes people feel welcome and makes people, builds their excitement about what they're going to experience. And so if you're an usher, your gesture, your smile, your welcome is ushering people. You are a gatekeeper. Usher is a gatekeeper. Musician is a gatekeeper. Because if your music all jacked up, people are going to be like, what? Or if your music is in another space and people are trying to figure, what? But if the music is in harmony with these gates that's getting ready to open, then people are like, oh, man, it's just putting me in the right frame of mind, in the right frame of spirit for what God is getting ready to do. There's all kinds of gatekeepers that are appointed. So this lifting, it says, lift your heads, gates. It's a personification of the gates. The gate, maybe that's a stretch for us to think of the gates having a head, but we got people who are gatekeepers. And our gatekeepers in this digital environment, gatekeepers are also in the digital space too. How we welcome people, how we let people know, social media. These are all gatekeepers. And this gate thing is open. If the gate is shut, nobody can come in. We can't come in if the gate is shut. And do y'all know that sometimes we spend a whole lot of energy in the church making sure the gate is locked? When we should be opening the gate, we're shutting it. And sometimes we don't even know that's what we're doing. Okay? So we're going to have to work better on opening, right? Opening the gate. Opening the gate so that what will happen. And the everlasting doors. See, the gates and the doors, two different things. Gates at the perimeter. The doors at the room. Okay? And it says everlasting or ancient doors, right? So that door, we don't have the key to that door. That's the door that God opens. See, we open the gate. We got the key to the gate. The King of Glory is the one with, that's their everlasting doors. The everlasting doors are open for the King of Glory to come in with strength, with might, with justice and vindication. The Lord of hosts who commands the armies of heaven. That last, it sounds repetitive, but who is the King of Glory? It tells different things. Who is the King of Glory? The Lord strong and mighty. The Lord mighty in battle. Those are different. The Lord of hosts. Those are three different names for God. Three different things that God does. The Lord of hosts is the one who commands the armies of heaven and is able to fight every battle for us and win. Now, if you fight a battle, I fight a battle. We may or may not win. We do our best, may or may not win. But if God is on your side, and if in worship you position yourself so that you realize, you let God know, let people know that God is going to fight my battle, then it's by your faith. If you believe that the Lord of hosts is on your side, every battle will be a victory if the battle belongs to God. Why do we worship? We worship to invite the Lord of heaven and earth to bring victory, peace, and blessing to every challenge, to every struggle we face. So I close with a line from Kurt Carr. For every mountain you brought me over, for every trial. See, you thought it was just you having a hard time. It's God testing you to see, are you going to get serious about your worship and serious about trusting God to get you over that mountain? And if you can't get over the mountain, then speak to the mountain, and the mountain will get out of your way. Every trial is trial. Oh, poor, you know, we so quickly feel, oh, poor me, poor me. Oh, me, I don't know why this happened to me. Well, there's a reason why it happened to you, because we need to see if you go trust God or not. I'm not saying you won't suffer. I'm not saying you won't have challenges if you worship God, but worship is going to make a difference in how you face it. And worship is going to make a difference. If the King of Glory is coming in, if the King of Glory is coming on strong, then all you got to do is get out the way. For every blessing, hallelujah. For this is the reason why we worship. For this, I give you praise. Let's pray. We're so thankful, God, for the soundtrack. We don't have the notes. We don't have the music, but we got the words that were spoken and sung in ancient Israel. The words of worship. Teach us, God, how to worship you. The earth is yours. You own it. You operate it. You love the people. You love the earth. Show us, God, how to position ourselves for the cleansing of our hands and the purification of our hearts. Show us, God, how to resist the idolatry and the deceit that has swept through our nation, our churches, our denominations, our political parties. God, we pray that as we worship, you will restore the truthfulness of our Christian witness in this nation,
Even in this nation's capital, God, increase the strength of our witness that we worship and we are true. We are not deceitful. We are not idolatrous. Heal our apostasy, God. And give us the courage and the holy boldness to stand for your truth. And God, we pray that every time we worship, instead of securing the gate, we'll open the gate. And God, we will do everything we can as we worship to worship a God who's opened the door. Open the door of our hearts to receive you. Open the door of our minds, God, for the renewal that your spirit brings to our thinking. Open our lives, God, so that you will inhabit our plans. You will inhabit our strategy. You will inhabit how we speak and how we face the challenges and the trials that we must confront in our homes, in our communities, in our world. God, we pray that you will show us that you are indeed poised and ready to fight our battles. So we worship you, we submit to you, and we declare beyond the shadow of a doubt that you have given us the victory. And we claim the victory as a consequence of our worship. Teach us, God, how to worship you is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's receive the benediction. Now to God who is able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we ask or think, according to the power that works in us. Unto God be glory in the church by Christ Jesus throughout all ages, world without end. The blessing of God for the people of God. Amen. Please allow the
earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof, the world and they that dwell therein. For he hath founded it upon the seas and established it upon the flood. Who shall ascend into the hill of the Lord, and who shall stand in his holy place? He that hath clean hands and a pure heart, who hath not lifted up his soul unto vanity, nor sworn deceitfully, he shall receive a blessing from the Lord and righteousness from the God of his salvation. This is the generation of them that seek him, that seek thy face, O Jacob. Lift up your heads, O ye gates, and be ye lifted up, ye everlasting doors, and the King of glory shall come in. Who is this King of glory? The Lord strong and mighty, the Lord mighty in battle. Lift up your hands, O ye gates, and be ye lifted up, ye everlasting doors, and the King. Did anybody come to worship the King? Can you extend your hands towards the heavens? I want to see somebody that don't mind laying prostrate before the Lord. Come on, team, let's lift the song. I worship you. For you are my righteousness. Hallelujah. You are royalty. So I crown you King of Kings. Can you bow and say, Your Majesty? Your Majesty. Oh.